Chrissy, you've done it again. So I watched Oppenheimer on its release day and it was amazing. I wanted to go for the full Barbenheimer experience, but my friend said no. Apparently watching almost 5 hours worth of movies in the same day is too much for some people. Fucking bait mail. Now let's start with the positive of this movie, on which I have many. Let's get the obvious one out of the way that everyone is expecting, long before the release. Yes, this is definitely, without question, the best looking film of the year. I know there are more films that are still awaiting to be released, like Killers of the Flower Moon and Poor Things, but and they haven't been released yet, and I know movies like Across the Spider-Verse came out this year, and they've all been praised for their amazing visuals. But I'm not changing my mind until one of those films replicates a fucking nuke exploding. Aside from the explosion, the rest of the visuals are just stunning as well. I mean, from a technical standpoint, this may be one of the best films made in the past decade. Every scene is so well structured and all the effects are used so incredibly well. I mean, the cinematography is amazing as well. I mean, every shot is just so crisp and pure. It's like Kubrick-esque, just every frame is a painting. And the little interjections he has where it's like all the audio will stop, or, you know, there'll be like flashing lights around him, or he'll start hallucinating and seeing things. It's all amazingly well done. And the audio in this film as well is just amazing. I mean, when that explosion goes off, you feel like your face is going to come off. I would strongly recommend seeing the film in IMAX for the best experience. Now, I know what you're thinking, and yes, I do like the visuals, and they are helped by Cillian Murphy's beautiful face and Florence Pugh's beautiful tip. But just the world this cinematography builds, the environment it presents, and the whole feeling of the film is just so immense and immersive. I also think the performances in this film are amazing. Cillian Murphy and Robert Downey Jr. in particular really stand out, but one of my favourite performances has to be Matt Damon. He's just so high energy and you can feel his stress through the screen. Unfortunately, I don't see anyone winning an Oscar for their performances in this film, at least not on the male side. Scorsese has an upcoming movie with Leo and De Niro, who are two of the greatest actors of all time. And along with Marty's impeccable direction, it seems nailed on that at least one of them will win either Best Lead or Best Supporting Actor. The person who I see stands the best chance at winning an Oscar on the performance side would be Florence Pugh, as she really portrays the unstable character amazingly. However, her lack of significant screen time may hinder that chance. However, I do think this film will probably win Best Picture. I mean, Killers of the Flower Moon's a Martin Scorsese film, so it's always got a chance, but it'll win either Best Director or Best Screenplay or Best Picture, if not all three. Now, it wouldn't be fair for me to gush over this movie without giving its due criticism, of which I do have a few. For a starter, this movie is long. And it's not a 3-hour movie that feels like a 2-hour movie, it definitely feels like a 3-hour movie. I did check my watch a couple of times, but it was only during some of the particularly dull scenes about physics of nukes and quantum theory that I don't fully understand. Go figure. This movie is decently paced. I mean, definitely not Nolan's best paced film, but it's fine. The issue I found is that the first 30 minutes of the movie is mainly just background on J. Robert Oppenheimer, and these scenes did feel quite rushed. We're supposed to get the impression that he's a security risk to America, but they never really show why, only that he occasionally advocated for having an open mind when it comes to foreign political affairs. Political affairs that I don't think America would even care about, and apart from the whole communist angle, which very clearly isn't even the case when you watch the film. There are also some scenes that went on for a bit too long. You know, the whole Congress meeting in black and white in particular dragged and didn't really seem to make sense, although this could be classic Nolan trying to urge the audience into re-watching the film. You know, there was a little twist at the end about Strauss that I don't want to get into, but you all know what I'm talking about. I don't understand fully the dynamic between Strauss and Oppenheimer. I get Strauss is supposed to be jealous of Oppenheimer for all his publicity and was upset by what he said at points, although I don't know why what he said upset him. But I just didn't fully understand why he'd go to such lengths working with the US government and completely baiting out everything about Oppenheimer and airing all his dirty laundry, and then sit before them in a committee, many of whom would probably have communicated with other members of the US government beforehand, and acted like he was okay with Oppenheimer. I know it was a public event and it would have damaged his reputation, but if he'd have just been honest, like, because it was clear that at that point many people didn't trust Oppenheimer, he still would have got away with it. I don't understand why he had to play this weird angle. And I also don't understand why he didn't tell the people on his defense counsel that he was really trying to get rid of Oppenheimer. I don't know why he was playing it like that. You know, he could have just told them and they wouldn't have done anything anyway. There was also a lot of names to try and keep track of, and like a lot. And they're not easy names like John Smith or David Jones, you know, they're all German or Russian or Jewish names like Einstein, Heisenberg, Strauss, Oppenheimer, Niels Bohr, Niedermayer, Teller, Van Winkelbonk, Bainbridge, Feynman, Rumpelstiltskin. I may have made some of those up. But the point is, again, that there's a lot of guys talking about foreign scientists, and most of the time you're watching and you're just like,
who the fuck is that guy?
All in all, I really enjoyed the movie. Definitely isn't without its flaws, but, and I wouldn't say it's for everyone. For starters, it's not going to be a popular film in Japan. But this film, I think, was made for people who really enjoy cinema and think that they're very clever and smarter than everyone else and like to explain things to people. Someone like me, for example. So I'd say if you're into history, great cinematography, Florence Pugh, explosions, Cillian Murphy, great acting, and just an all-around great immersive cinema experience, I would strongly recommend seeing Oppenheimer if you haven't already. However, one thing I do think is that it is definitely a film made for cinema, and that's the case in a lot of Nolan films like Interstellar and Inception. All of these films are very visually stunning on like big screens like cinemas or if you've got a great TV at home, but if you're watching on a tablet or a little laptop screen, it's not going to be as great. And I feel like once the whole cinematography wears away and you don't have that anymore, the film's not going to be anywhere near as good as it was. But he detonated a fucking nuke in the desert, like what do you want him to do? So if you like this video, it's just a quick little review, getting my thoughts on it. I'm sure all of you would have seen this movie already and fucking loved it. So let me know your thoughts on the movie in the comments. Let me know what you think of my review, whether you liked or disliked it. Make sure to subscribe to stay up to date with the channel. Like this video if you want to see more content like this and so that more people can see this. But anyway, if you did enjoy the video, leave a like, subscribe as always, and I'll see you in the next video. Peace.